South Bay Presbyterian Church. I'm Kelly Chan, and my fellow students, welcome to you all this morning. A couple of reminders for those of you who turn on.
I guess you can hear me better now, especially those of you online. Silence is golden. Just reminders that for all you have cell phones, to silence your cell phones. And if I remember, I'll tell you to turn them back on after the service is over. Because I usually it's Tuesday or Wednesday before I remember. For those of you online, I'd like to welcome you and to see all your smiling faces. Hey, Jules, I see your hand.
Who was that?
Thank you, Jules. Whoa. All right. Bring it on by for our snacks afterwards. Okay. So today's call to worship is from Psalms 113, verses 1 through 3. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore, from the rising of the sun to the place where it sets. Join me in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, we just give thanks for this opportunity to gather together freely to worship you. We just pray that you would send the Holy Spirit to direct this service so it is in a manner that's pleasing to you. We just ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. When God created man, he created him with the sole purpose to worship God. And so this morning we come before him as his people, as his children, as his creation to worship him. So I'd ask if you can, if you're able to, please stand us as we begin singing our worship to God.
And
Heavenly Father, this through us, we pray that people can see how great you are. Through your creation, we pray, Lord, that people will come to know you, that we will reach out, and that we will spread your name through all of the world until every tongue confesses that you are God. Thank you for being in the midst of our worship service this morning. In your Son's precious name, amen. You may be seated.
I'm a reading, and today's scripture is from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 14 to 18. After John was put in prison, Jesus went unto Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. May God add his blessings on the reading of his word.
My pleasure to welcome back Tom Steers to the pulpit. For those of you who don't know Tom, back in 1976, he decided to integrate True Light. And he showed up and he found a Chinese church to worship with. Another fact about Tom, some of you don't may not know that he was one of the original core families that started this church. He stayed for a couple of years until his children, Phil's needs of his children had changed and he had to leave. So welcome back, Tom, and his wife, Dana, sitting back there. I want you to greet them after the service.
So we have some pictures of my family that I wanted to share with you. Thank you. First of all, here we have daughter Joy on the left and daughter Anna on the right. Joy being a kindergarten teacher at Seaside in Torrance, the elementary school, and Anna being a professor at Long Beach State, plus running Steers Studio, a kind of a coaching and a time for people to learn their acting skills. She does a lot of help with people that are going to do auditions. And also at the end of May, she's putting on a play in Santa Monica, and just finished doing a film. So she's kind of an activist. So that's our two daughters, not yet married, in case you have any relatives. Talk to me. I'm really from India, and I do, you know, India, I enforce marriage from the top down. Here's my son. Chip and his wife Kelly and their two boys, Thomas and Henry. Up in Marin, he recently, besides being a full-time employee of Juniper Networks, he published a book on all the plants of Mount Temple Pius in John Muir Woods. So he's got a bestseller out there. You ought to get it. So, one more, I think. Oh, there's the Mr. and Mrs. Okay, and thankfully, my wife's in the back, and she's here today with me to hear me preach. All right. Okay, let's go. How would you like to be the one preaching today? What an honor and a responsibility, isn't it? After Jeff asked me to give the message today, I didn't have a clear idea at all of what to be bringing. So I asked two prayer groups to pray for me, to pray for what Jesus wanted to say today at South Bay Presbyterian Church. So today's sermon is an answer to their prayers and to mine. And we will be drilling down into the words of Jesus. So he's going to be speaking. What he said 2,000 years ago is still relevant and good for today. My title today is Eight to Change the World. What are the eight? Slide. There they are. They are the words of Jesus out of that section that was read. The time has come. Good news. Kingdom of God. Repent. Believe. Come. Follow me. Fish for people. And being a missionary, you know that this is a great message. First, what time is it? Jesus said the time has come. Timing is everything. For us, it is now. What did Apostle Paul write to the Corinthians to wake them up? I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. 2 Corinthians 6, 2. The question is, how are we doing spiritually right now? There's no more important question than that. Right now, how are we doing spiritually right now? Secondly, let's look at the words good news. What pops into your mind when you hear the words good news? Does salvation or God's love? Perhaps eternal life, the hope of eternal life? Do they come to your mind? They're good. These are good words and they're true. But Jesus says here in the scriptures, it's the good news of the kingdom. Now, I will talk a little bit more about the kingdom shortly, but here is a really important question. When does the good news become the bad news? As our Asian American ministry flowed into Hindu, Muslim, and Buddhist families, we learned that the good news was most often being understood as bad news. Why? It was bad news since it was culturally Western and most often extracted individuals from their families. We had to change gears. If at all possible, good news should help people become followers of Jesus within their families and cultures. The question for us today is, how can we bring and proclaim the good news within our families and culture? Now, thirdly, let's consider the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom? Have you studied it? The word kingdom is mentioned 155 times in the New Testament. 54 of them are in Matthew alone. The importance of the kingdom can't be overstated. Remember, Jesus said to seek first the kingdom. He said, the kingdom of God is within you. How do we apply these statements to our lives? How many times have we prayed, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? What's our anticipation of that prayer being answered? Here's another reason why it's so important. In Acts 1:3, Jesus spoke to his disciples for 40 days before ascending about the kingdom of God. 40 days on the kingdom. Wow. Don't you wonder what he taught them? Doesn't this show us how important the kingdom of God is? I have a personal testimony about this. I'll share. During the summer of 1968, after being editor of a university newspaper, I was offered an internship with a United States senator in D.C. for the summer, which I rejected. I believe the Holy Spirit led me to read the New Testament for the very first time. This changed the course of my life completely. not only did I fall in love with Jesus, I also found the answer in the kingdom. For war, racism, Eastern religions, drugs, hippie philosophy, communism, Maoism at that time, socialism, anarchy, capitalism, democracy, and politics. The answer's in the kingdom. I found the kingdom realm that completely operates above everything else. I was hooked. So I did my own personal version of tune in, turn on, and drop out. I dropped out of college and went to study the Bible at Capron Ray Bible School for a year, a place in the northern part of England. And while walking in those pastoral hills of North England, I did something very, very important. I made a prayer of total surrender. I said, Lord, use me to change this miserable world. That prayer was 55 years ago. And as you know, Dana and I have had several missionary assignments. We've been in Brazil. I was in the Philippines. She was in Japan. But I counted up the other day, and I thought, oh my goodness, God has blessed me to step foot. Not necessarily every one of them have a big ministry, but I've been in 37 countries. You know, it's like, wow, I prayed to use me to change the miserable world, but he also sent me to all these different places. Let's look at the next word, repent. What comes to your mind hearing that word? Is it someone with a sign on a street corner or at a football game? Repent. To repent means making the decision to turn to God. It's written 54 times in the New Testament. What makes us willing to repent? Isn't it when we feel sorrow, regret, contrition? Isn't it when we are full of ourselves and feel separated from God and His will? Or when we fail? Or when we feel unholy? Or when we sin? Or when we feel like we're broken? Whatever our motivation, isn't it wonderful? The Lord Jesus is inviting us to turn to Him. Repent means turn. Even when we feel lousy, defeated, or self-centered. A good example of repentance is in the life of Paul, the apostle. At his conversion, what happened to him? What did he do? He fell on the ground when Jesus spoke to him. Later in life, again, in writing to Timothy, 1 Timothy 1, 15 and 16, he continues to demonstrate a repentive attitude. He told Timothy two times, I am the worst of sinners. What's your experience with the word repent? The fifth word Jesus mentioned is believe. It's not just enough to turn away to repent. He's asking us to turn towards Him. We know why we should turn to Jesus and believe in Him. It's clear. He proved Himself as God, especially through His miracles, His death, and His resurrection. The word believe is in the Gospel of John 84 times. John really, really embraced that word. His sole purpose in writing the Gospel is stated in chapter 20, verse 31, that we might believe that Jesus is the Christ. Now, in my opinion, there's no better way to describe what it means to believe in Jesus than the metaphor in John 15:5. When Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches, if you abide in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit." You need to crank up your imagination here. Can you imagine yourself as a branch? It's not a very pretty picture, is it? Kind of woody with spurs and nodes. Maybe if you're like me, you have a little hair on your branch. The main point is this. We are attached to this vine, fully adhering to it, clinging to it. We are totally surrendered to this vine, 100%. That's it. That's believing in Jesus and having relational faith in him. Personally, I love this illustrative metaphor. As we truly abide in the vine in faith, in prayers, in the Word of God, eventually the Spirit of God blesses us with much fruit. This has been so true of our lives. Have you experienced this? I hope so. Even though all of us have battles, whatever battles we have, they will eventually find resolution and victory in the true vine. The sixth word is come, Jesus said. What a gracious and loving invitation. Come. Our holy God, the God who rules the whole world and history, is saying, come. Jesus also said this in Matthew 11:28. Remember? Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Our God is so relational. He loves us so much with such a perfect and deep love that we hardly can comprehend it. Doesn't it remind you of the prodigal son? The father runs to meet his wayward son, throws his arms around him, and kisses him, welcoming him home. Doesn't it remind you of Revelation 3:20 when Jesus says, if anyone opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. What a love feast, having a meal with our Savior and Lord. What an honor we get to come. The sixth phrase is follow me. Come and follow, they go together. They both are this wonderful, gracious, and loving invitation. Jesus said this 2,000 years ago, but he also is saying to us today. When you hear him saying, follow me, what comes to your mind? In other words, how are any of us truly following Jesus? What does it entail? In the Gospel of Luke in 9:23, I think Jesus makes it even more clear. If anyone would come after me, he must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. Wow. What does it mean to deny ourselves? How do we do this? What does it mean to take up our cross in order to follow Jesus? Apostle Paul said two things that help us here. In Philippians 1:19, he said, for me to live is Christ. But then again in Galatians 2:20, he said, I am crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live. Do you get it? Our Lord's, Jesus' invitation is all-encompassing. It's everything. One way to say it is this: either Jesus is Lord of all or Lord not at all. Isn't this saying hard? There are so many other things in life that are calling us to follow. I get it. There's so many things. But to be a follower, you got to follow Jesus. Finally, in number 8, we see followers of Christ are enrolled in his school. He enrolled us in his master's practicum class called Fishing for People. My NIV Bible says Fishing for Men, but then the latest editions of NIV say Fishing for People because the word is anthropoled and it's not the word for man. It's for men and women. Fishing for people. Here's a really interesting question. As you are following Jesus, what has he been teaching you about fishing for people? Let me process this with you a bit here. Jesus wasn't just talking about individually fishing for people. Yes, as individuals, he's leading us to fish for people and teaching us how to be and share the good news with others. Some people even have an extra gift of evangelism. Remember Billy Graham. But few have this gift. Most of us are being taught by the Lord to share the good news by our lives and testimonies. Sometimes people see our lives and are curious. An effective way to fish is asking our family members or our friends questions like, do you have an interest in the spiritual side of life? Or do you have a spiritual dimension to your life? These kinds of open, non-intrusive questions are how the Lord has taught me to be more sensitive. And I can ask them almost always after developing a sense of bonding or trust with anybody. Because once you kind of establish that initial friendship, you can ask them about, you know, hey, do you have a spiritual side to your life? It's not that intrusive. And it's wonderful to see how people respond. If there's a noticeable openness or curiosity in our conversation, that's when I can ask another question, like, have you read the words of Jesus for yourself? Often people haven't. They've taken it off the TV or they went to a church as a kid and they said, forget it. And then I can ask them another question. How would you like to read with me one time and see if you like it? If you meet someone like this in the church community, it's good. It's helpful because they're already past the church barrier. But if this pre-believer is not at church, I would suggest you meet them at Denny's or Starbucks for your reading. Why? They might have really negative feelings about churches, Christianity, or evangelicals. And they only need to know Jesus by reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. That's their priority. That's their first priority. And our priority is in helping them do that. There's a lot more than fishing individually. when Jesus spoke about fishing, he talked to fishermen who normally fished with nets, not individual fishing rods. So using evangelistic nets to me is how most people come to Christ. The net is either a family, a church community, a group of friends, or a Bible study. By inviting pre-believers to a group event, they could get curious about the Lord and the spiritual dimension. South Bay Presbyterian Church has always fished with nets. Before there was ever a worship service, we had VBS at St. Luke's. And the core team hosted monthly gatherings in homes where we invited anyone we knew with the hopes that they would be at the new church when we were starting. I remember Christmas party, Valentine's party, Chinese New Year's party. Some of you might remember them too. I was so happy that that was happening because when we did go to a worship service, we had a number of people that were interested. It was a great way to fish with a net. I remember the How to Raise Teenager sessions at Gary and Ronnie's house. Some of you might remember that. Speaking of them, Randy Lee went to school with Ronnie. Because there was a group in those days called the Chinese Cultural Association of the South Bay, Randy, Evelyn, Dana, and I joined. That's how we were able to invite them and Steve and Barbara as well to our new church plant at the Y. It's an example of fishing with a net, being out there, interacting socially and culturally with people. Today, I know at South Bay Presbyterian Church, I know you're continuing the net approach. For example, you host the Christmas celebration, the over 50 group events, Taste the Missions dinner, and the Alpha study that happened last week. To catch fish, you need some practical items like a hook or a net. I was thinking about that, and I was thinking one of the greatest and best fishing tools that you use at this church, which is so great, is your loving hospitality and food. I used to say, until I gained too much weight, I used to say, the food is the ministry, and the ministry is food. And I joke about having a Buddha building. However, regardless, having meals out at home or at church are always a good way to fish. What a blessing you can plan events inviting pre-believing family members, friends, neighbors, etc., as the first step in fishing for people. I'm going to conclude now, and there's two ways I want to conclude. One is, this is the word of the Lord to the South Bay Presbyterian Church. The time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Come and follow Jesus. And as you do that, he will send you out to fish for people and teach you how to fish. That's one way I wanted to close. But I'd like to close in prayer. And the reason I'd like to close in prayer is I've been talking about coming to Jesus and following him. And In 1967, I went to a conference, inter-varsity conference. It was like this, group of people. I sat in the back. I wasn't a believer at all. I never grew up in church, didn't know what was going on. I hated the word sin whenever they mentioned it. But those people had love like you guys, and they had joy like you guys. And the speaker said, okay, everyone bow your head. So everyone bowed their head. And I'd like to ask you right now to bow your heads as I close in prayer. Eyes closed, heads bowed. At that conference, the man who was speaking said, if anyone wants to turn, come to Jesus and follow him, please look up. And so I did. And I'm asking you, if any of you have never, for the first time, have never turned to Jesus, coming to him and following him, and you want to, please look up. Lord Jesus, thank you. What are we that you would love us so much to invite us to turn, to come and follow you? And then you want us to help others. What a privilege, what an honor. Thank you. Thank you so much that life is all about this spiritual dimension called the kingdom. And that rules the world, not politics or culture. Even families. Your kingdom is the family that's going to go on forever and ever and ever. And thank you today for all those here at this meeting that want to know you better and follow you. Would you reveal yourself to them and help them? Send the Spirit to them and make them hungry like you did to me to know you. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Spirit and truth, pouring out the oil.
been asked to do the pastoral prayer. So please join me in prayer. Bow your heads. Again, Lord, we thank you for being here. Your presence is with us. And thank you for all who you are. And today, we want to say thank you for being a God of grace. We are people that are weak, but you said that you are strong and that our weaknesses will be made perfect. Your grace will be made perfect in our weakness. And I'd like to pray for anybody that's in church here or online that has a ailment or a healing that's going on, that your grace would be sufficient. You would give them a gift of grace, whether it's comfort, encouragement, or healing. For those here that are with, it seems that in my experience that getting a little bit older, you get a lot of aches and pains and different things. And Lord, your gift of grace for all of us who are getting older, that in our weakness, we'll see the gift of grace coming and encouraging us and helping us. Lord, we want to thank you today for this lighthouse of this church and how it has its tentacles all over the community, through the families, through the couples, through the singles that are part of this church. And Lord, we thank you that we can ask you to keep blessing them with your teaching on how to do the fishing you want them to do, either individually or as a group. And Lord, thank you for the Alpha program that's happening. We thank you so much for this outreach and the fact that even a couple came to that are seekers. We pray that there will be a Holy Spirit experience drawing people to them, to yourself, through that Alpha time as it goes forward. And then, Lord, today we want to pray for all the missionaries. Thank you for how this church has been a mission church, supporting missionaries like Dana and myself. Thank you for that blessing, that honor that they bestow on the missionaries. We know that the missionaries are consumed with wanting to see you work. And we ask you to just show up and be in their lives, and so they know your presence. And as they abide in you and you abide in them, there will be much fruit. And then, Lord, there's a sister in Christ, Sawawu, and she is going through a lot of physical tribulations and problems, but she's encouraged. And we would pray that you'll continue to encourage her and to help her. And that in her suffering, Lord, she will remember you and how you suffered and how you're acquainted with grief. You know and can identify with her. And then, Lord, I there's another request that comes to mind, and that's this girl that wants help, who's been abused and has abandonment issues. And Dana will be meeting with her next Sunday, and we pray for that to be a very successful time by your Spirit. and there will be a kind of an atmosphere of truth telling going on there, that there could be some honesty, even from a teenager, about the real things of life. So thank you. Thank you for this time of intercession. I don't know where Pastor Chris is, but we ask you to bless him with your presence and take good care of him as he's not here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have a couple of announcements. First one is about our offering. Just a reminder that there are ways to give physically via the U.S. mail, bill pay, or we even take cash. So the boxes are in the back, and you can feel free to mail your checks and or just drop them off. Okay, and now I'd like to welcome Arthur to give us a report on Alpha.
Good morning. It is so, so nice to see so many people here today, a lot of loving faces. I have a question for you. When I mention the word Alpha, what do you think of? Okay, right? Okay, so a lot of people are thinking about Alpha because Pastor Chris has said it over and over again for the past few weeks, right? And so anything else when you think of Alpha? Think of other words associated with Alpha? Those of you that were in college and went to like fraternities and sororities, there were a lot of Alphas there, right? I don't know. Yes, the beginning, alphabets. There's actually another Alpha. I think we have a slide. You remember that? Good old school Alpha Beta, right? So we're surrounded by Alpha, all right? Pastor Chris, over the weeks, has been announcing the coming of Alpha, but, you know, Alpha is an opportunity for us as individuals and as a church family to fish for people, just like Tom had mentioned. And so I'm here to say, not Alpha is coming, but Alpha has arrived. Yes. So this past Wednesday, we actually had our first Alpha session. I believe we had over 50 people join us. So it actually was actually a very, very good event. A lot of really good discussion and thought-provoking opportunities for us to interact with ourselves and with visitors. And so I want to encourage you to grab a flyer, grab a postcard that we have out there, still have opportunities to invite our neighbors, our friends to join us this Wednesday. And once again, you know, it's just a nice, casual, safe place for us to discuss life and belief and God. So see you on Wednesday.
My memory's not that good, so I need to have these reminders from Stan on what my announcements I'm supposed to make. So save the date, Saturday, May 4th at 9:00. We're having a prayer breakfast here as part of the National Prayer Day of Prayer, and we even have a special guest, someone that we've met before, Reverend Shannon Kuhn, who will be giving the message. Next announcement: save the date, Mother's Day lunch. Okay, it's something that we would the day we come together to honor all the mothers and spiritual mothers, to honor them as they give us their loving care. More details to follow, so hopefully we'll, as the plans are becoming involved, I know it's going to be food. That's the only thing I know is food. Okay, next. And the last announcement is a meal request. If you'd like to support Sharon Yee and or Evelyn Lee after their surgery, providing a meal please talk to a deacon or refer to Friday's e-letter for signups. As you know, they both are recovering from surgery. Evelyn is online and Sharon is here. So please pray for them also for their recovery. And now I'd like to ask you to stand for the benediction. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we just give thanks for the opportunity to come here today. Just give thanks for all your blessings upon us. And as we leave, just allow us, the Spirit, to be with us so that we may be light and salt to the world. And you just pray that you would bless the continuing time of fellowship as we share a meal with the other. For we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.